Greetings to all of you, and today we are going to begin the sixth class of the Modern India Spectrum. And within this week or the next one, basically in 5 to 6 more classes, we will be completing Spectrum. So the chapters which we are going to do today are 14th, 15th and the 16th one. And for to get these chapters, regular updates, which classes are going on, and you can join the Telegram group as well as the channel. You will be getting this PDF file and everything on the Telegram group, so you can join that. And also quizzes are going to come up on the Telegram channel, so you can join that as well. The links are given in the description. So, and there is a test of Indian polity on Sunday, and you are requested to revise from the lectures which have been uploaded in the Indian polity section, and the notes are also in the group. So now, without wasting much time, I'll begin. So now the first chapter is the First World War and the nationalist response. Now the nationalist response to British in the First World War was threefold. Basically there were three types of people and they responded differently. Moderates, about whom which we have studied earlier, they supported the empire as a matter of duty. Extremists, that is Tilak and all of those, supported the war efforts in the belief that Britain will repay the loyalty with gratitude in the form of self-government. So basically it was something like that, that because we are helping the British, they will do good to us. So that is why the extremists favored them. Now revolutionaries are those who decided to utilize this opportunity to wage a war on the British. Now those who were supporting them, basically moderates and the extremists, supporter of the British war efforts, failed to see that the imperialist powers, basically the powers who were fighting the world war and those who wanted to control the colonies, were fighting to safeguard their own colonies and markets. So basically the fight was not that the colonies should be given independence or something. The fight was that who should control all the colonies. The war seemed a heaven-sent opportunity which drained India of troops. Basically the army had to go out to fight the wars at different areas. So that is why the number of troops in India was less. Also there was a possibility of financial and military help from the German and Turkey, that is enemies of the British. So now war is going on between Britain and its enemies. So its enemies always have a possibility of helping the enemy of the enemy. So they are natural friends. Home Rule League movement. This is how the Indian responded to the First World War, through the Home Rule League movement. Now these are the prominent leaders. Now you can go through them. Now they decided that we will form a national alliance that would work throughout the year, unlike the Congress which had an annual session. So Tilak, Annie Besant and others decided that we should have a setup which is working throughout the year rather than the Congress, because Congress annual session takes place and rest all the leaders are gone into inactivity. So the main objective was demanding self-government or home rule for all of India within the British Commonwealth. In the end, so they are saying that there should be one, but actually two home rule leagues were launched, one by Tilak and the other by Annie Besant. Factors leading to the movement. Popular pressure was required to attain concessions. They felt that if we need concessions from the Britain, we need to maintain that pressure on them. Moderates were disillusioned with the Morley Minto reforms. We know that the Morley Minto reforms were criticized by the Congress. Burden of wartime miseries caused by high taxation and rise in prices. The war being fought among the major imperialist powers, backed by naked propaganda against each other, exposed the myth of white superiority. So until now, the psychological reason for allowing the Britishers to rule was that they had claimed that they are a race which is greater than other races. They are superior. But now when this fight was going on, all of the sides, basically Britain, Germany, Turkey, all of them were whites, and they took out a series of propaganda, and basically they took out mass media campaigns to show their misdeeds to their colonies. So basically so that the colonies would not support Britain in war, they started publishing those newspaper and journals which showed that how unjust the British have been to their colonies. Same thing was done by Britain for Germany and Turkey. So this led to a situation where everybody got to know that white man is not superior. They are extremely selfish. Tilak was ready to assume the leadership after his release. Now, after the Bengal movement, he was jailed. And he made conciliatory gestures to the government that he will be loyal. And also to the moderates, he said, I will not take any extreme step now. He urged all the Indians to assist British government in the hour of crisis. Now the leagues. Both Tilak and Besant realized that the sanction of the moderate dominated Congress as well as full cooperation of the extremists was essential for the movement to succeed. So now what they have realized is that the Surat split of 1907 stopped the progress of the national movement. So before launching the league, they tried at the 1914 session to reach out to the moderates to bring back the extremists in the Congress. So this is called as moderate extremist rapprochement. Tilak and Besant decided to revive political activity on their own. Now these talks failed, so they decided, okay, now we have no other option, so we will continue. Annie Besant launched a campaign to demand self-government through the newspapers New India and Commonweal. So these two are written by Annie Besant. In 1915, the efforts of Tilak and Besant met with some success. It was decided that the extremists will be admitted to the Congress. Okay, so in the 1915 session, what happened was that there was a general consensus made. So it took her one more year to do that. Although Besant failed to get the Congress to approve her scheme of home rule leagues. So now the position of the moderates are that yes, you are right, that when we are not together, we lower the speed of the national movement. But after this, Annie Besant told them that please admit the extremists. They agreed. They have now passively agreed that yes, in the next session we will take them, but they have not agreed to support the Home Rule League move, because moderates are of the view that it is a duty that you should support Britain in the war. Tilak's League. Tilak's name is Indian Home Rule League. In April 1916 it was set up. First meeting was at Belgaum. Pune was the headquarters. The league was restricted to Maharashtra, Karnataka, central provinces and Berar. And in Maharashtra also, it was not including Bombay city. The demands included Swarajya, formation of linguistic states and education in the vernacular. Now Besant's League, All India Home Rule League, that is in Madras. This was set up in Madras. George Arundale was the organizing secretary. B.W. Wadia and C.P. Ramaswamy Iyer were another important persons. Now, what was the program of this Home Rule League? It aimed to convey to the common man that the message of the Home Rule was self-government. Now, they also wanted to attract the backward regions of Gujarat and Sindh, politically backward. Means they had not shown much participation in Gujarat and Sindh. So, their another aim was to activate those regions. Now, this was to be achieved by promoting political education and discussion through public meetings, organizing libraries and reading rooms, and basically all the types of things which were available for mass media. See, television was not there, social media was not there. So you can see that they have tried everything else. May it be postcard, pamphlet, poster, newspaper, plays, religious songs, collecting funds. They have tried everything to do this. Now, Russian Revolution proved to be an added advantage for the Home Rule campaign. See, in the Russian Revolution, Russia overthrows the Tsarist regime, that is a dictatorial regime, and also frees all the colonies which are under their control. So this is a revolution which the Indians are waiting for. They see that the Russians have been able to realize that basically keeping a country dependent on you is not good. So why do you not also free the British? British were also asked, why do you also not give us self-rule? Home Rule was joined by Motilal Nehru, Jawaharlal Nehru. So basically these are the leaders. Important name are Motilal Nehru, Jawaharlal Nehru and Muhammad Ali Jinnah. So Lala Lajpat Rai also. So these are those leaders who became prominent because of the Home Rule League now. Earlier we have not read the name of Jawaharlal Nehru till now. So it is the Home Rule League through which he starts his political career. Now Muhammad Ali Jinnah was extremely important because he led the Bombay Division. Bombay Division was with Annie Besant. Moderate congressmen were delusional with Congress, so they also joined, and Gokhale's Servants of India Society also joined. Now, who stayed away? Anglo-Indians, Muslims and non-Brahmins from the south. non-Brahmins from the south were afraid that when the Home Rule League will win, or basically when Home Rule will come, it will mean that the Hindu majority will make all the laws and then the British will not be there to protect them. So they decided to not take part in the movement. Now government's attitude, government was very severe in the repression, because see, a world war is going on and now you are agitating, so the government will be very angry and they will beat up the protesters. Tilak was barred from entering Punjab and Delhi. Annie Besant, B.P. Wadia and George Arundel were arrested, and it is said that the repression was so brutal that Sir S. Subramania Iyer renounced his knighthood. Now why the agitation faded out by 1919? There was lack of effective organization. There will be actually no effective organization because the leaders are also taken away. Communal rights were witnessed during 1917 and 18. The moderates who had joined the Congress after Annie Besant's arrest were pacified by the talks of reforms. They were told that the reforms are coming up, so please do not worry. Now this is another policy of carrot and stick which they used earlier. The moderates are being told that reforms are coming, and then the extremists are saying that we will do passive resistance. So the talk of passive resistance by extremists will keep the moderates away. Now Montagu-Clemford reforms, which became known, further divided the nationalist ranks. So now there were some section of the moderates who were very happy with the moderate Montagu-Clemford reform. So they decided that yes, the Britishers are giving us. So again, a split in the Congress was not the split in terms of actual split, but a split or division among the Congress members was seen, and so full effectiveness of the Congress was not seen here. Now Tilak had to go abroad with connection to a libel case against Valentine Kirrell. See, she wrote a book, Indian Unrest, and said that Tilak is responsible for all the bad politics which is happening in India. So there was a case filed, and he went abroad to fight that case. Now Gandhi's fresh approach has also emerged by now. The new tactics employed by Gandhiji had come up, and he started to take part in those. Basically, the youth were shifted towards Gandhi's non-violent methods, and they were seeing what is happening. Gandhi accepted the presidentship of All India Home Rule League and changed the organization name to Swaraj Sabha. Positive gains. Now it marked the transition between the deliberative and rather inactive nature of the Congress. Basically, this phase has become that the inactive nature of the Congress, and till the time Gandhiji has come, it has made Congress more representative, shifted the emphasis from the educated elite to the masses, and it created an organizational link between town and the country. So basically now in every town there is a setup, you know, a machinery. So basically when the Home Rule League was there, Home Rule League set up its offices in all the centers of India. So these offices are later utilized by the Congress. It created generation of ardent nationalists and prepared the masses for politics of Gandhian style. August 1907, Montagu Declaration was influenced by the Home Rule agitation. Now, Moderate Extremist Union at Lucknow. So this was another effect of the movement, that because Tilak and Besant had made the efforts, so moderate extremists were reunited in Lucknow and lent a new dimension and a sense of urgency to the national movement. Now, Lucknow session of the Indian National Congress. The first thing which is happening is that extremists are readmitted to the Congress. The president was Ambika Charan Mazumdar, and finally he readmitted the extremists. Factors were that old controversies had become meaningless now. Both moderates and extremists realized that the split had led to political inactivity. Annie Besant and Tilak made vigorous efforts for the reunion, and they also said that we will support a reform of the administration and not an overthrow of the government. Tilak also denounced acts of violence. The death of two moderates, Gokhale and Firoz Shah Mehta, they are the two main people who were resisting the coming back of extremists in the Congress. So they both have died now. Lucknow pact between the Congress and Muslim League. Another thing which happened in this session was that a pact was signed between the Muslim League and the Congress. Now, what was happened that they will sign a pact that they will present common demands to the government. Basically, League and Congress will come together and will give the demands to the British government. Why is this change? Earlier, whatever the Congress did, the League used to oppose. Now, why is this change in the League's attitude? Britain's refusal to help Turkey. Now, British refused to help Turkey during the war and after the war. So, the Muslims were angered by this because the ruler of Turkey was seen to be the ruler of the Islamic world at that time. Now, annulment of the partition of Bengal. Now, Bengal had been earlier partitioned, we saw, and it a huge movement was there. But there was also a section of the Muslim elites which was happy because the East Bengal was Muslim majority province. So, this thing happened again. Partition was done away with. So, Muslim League had supported the partition at that time. So, now they are angry with the British that why did you take away East Bengal from us. The refusal of the British government to set up university in Aligarh. We see that Aligarh was the main center of Muslim education or educating the Muslims at that time. So, the British refused them to set up a university there. The younger League members were turning bolder nationalistic politics. The Calcutta session of the Muslim League had committed to working with other groups for self-government and provided that it did not come in conflict with the objective of protection of Muslims. So basically now in the 1912 session of the Muslim League, there was an open declaration that now we will work with other groups who are also looking for self-government for India. And we will work with those groups who do not hamper the interest of Indian Muslims. So, nature of the pact, another reason was that they were infuriated by the repression during First World War. So, Maulana Azad wrote Al Hilal and Muhammad Ali wrote Comrade. So, basically, they faced a lot of repression during the First World War and the Muslim nationalists were angered by this. Nature of the pact. The League agreed to present joint constitutional demands with the Congress to the government. So, this is the outcome of the demand that Congress and League have come together. Congress accepted the League's position on separate electorates. So, basically the thing which has happened is that Congress has accepted that it is okay if you continue to have separate electorates. So, now basically the divide and rule policy of the government has been given approval by the Congress. So, otherwise what the correct scheme of things should have been? That the Muslim fears would have been allied by the Congress and they would have said that we will take proper care of you, do not go into the lap of the British for that. Okay. They were also granted a fixed proportion of seats in the legislature at All India and provincial levels. And now what were the demands? That government should declare that it would give self-government at an early date. So now see, look at the vagueness of the demand. See, you have recognized separate electorates and giving more excess of representation to the Muslims. But what are you getting in return? They will jointly say that it should confer self-government at an early date. Neither the present date is known nor the early date is known. So see, this is actually very vague. Representative assembly should be expanded with elected majority and more powers. So, there also they have not given any date. They are asking a reform in the councils, but they are not mentioning till when, how, what should be the nature. So, these are just four vaguely worded and general demands. And the term of the legislature should be 5 years. Salary of the Secretary of the State should be paid by the British Treasury and not drawn from the Indian funds. So, this is very important. If you get to get this question in prelims, it will be in the nature of polity. But this can help you to remember this. So whenever this comes up, that when was the salary of the Secretary of the State will be given from British Treasury and not India, it will be the Government of India Act 1919. You can recall at that time that in the Lucknow session this pact was signed and this was in one of the demands. So it is natural that it will be Government of India Act 1919. Half of the members of Viceroy's Provincial Governor Council should be Indians. Now, the critical comments or analysis of whatever has happened in the Lucknow Pact. Now, executive as a whole was not responsible to the legislature. You see, here they are just saying that Indians should be given more representation and members of Viceroy's Provincial Governors Council should be Indians. So basically now they can put any Indians, they can take the princes, those who are supporting, even basically these demands were not accepted, but had they been accepted, they could have, the British could have taken loyalist members in the Indian, big zamindars, big merchants, big bankers, who will always listen to the British. Second thing is that even if the executive was Indian, he was not responsible to the legislature. The legislature could not remove, because the government is run by 1909 Act. There is no responsibility on the executive of the parliament. But here they have called for a representative parliament. So if the parliament has more powers and the Indians are given representation to it, then budget will come under their control. So this will make a deadlock. Now the government will, executive will say that no, I want to use money for this, but the what we say, Indians will say no, use it like this. So there will be no expenditure and governance will go into the gutter. While the effort of the Congress and the Muslim League to put up a united front was far-sighted one, but the acceptance of separate electorates implied that Congress and League came together as separate entities. Now basically imagine a situation that the Muslim League and the Congress had come up together on their own by seeing the atrocities that are committed on the Indian people. Then you could have said that there is a birth of nationalism, there is Hindu Muslim unity. But see, this is a deal, this is a kind of a contract. So the leaders of the both the parties will come together. But in fact, there is no effort by them to bring the masses. Now see, this becomes a major landmark in the evolution of two-nation theory. So now, Congress were the major representative of India and the League were the major representative of Indian Muslims. So after the British will go, these two parties will remain in India after we know what will happen. So these two parties will remain. So now, once it is decided that those who are going to take the power after the British go, they see Hindus and Muslims as separate entities. So it will be a landmark in the evolution of two-nation theory. The leaders of the two groups came together. Efforts to bring together the masses from the two communities were not considered, as I told you, that there were no effort to bring the masses together. But the good thing which happened was there was a lot of enthusiasm among the people by this reunion. Now Montagu's statement, earlier we studied that Montagu's statement was beneficial for the British, so that moderates and extremists could be divided again. So what was the statement? The only statement given was, see, basically there were doubts on the British intentions to give self-government, and the participation in the war was becoming increasingly difficult for Indians. So he decided to give this statement that increasing participations in Indians in administration and gradual development of self-governing institution with a view for responsible government in India is an integral part of British Empire. So this together, if it is read together, it becomes very complex. But if you see it, he is saying that in participation of Indians will be there and development of self-governing institutions with a view to progressive realization of responsible government in India as an integral part of the British Empire. So basically they will allow us to become have a responsible government, but you will remain a part of the British Empire. So now from now onwards, the demand for self-government or home rule could not be termed as seditious. See, because in the Government of India Act 1909, there is no mention of responsible government. There is minority in the legislatures. The Indians are elected minority is there. But now they have saying that there will be self-government given to you. Self-government means that the government will be responsible. The government will be looking to involve Indians and it will take care of the Indians. So now if somebody demanded home rule, he could not be termed as seditious. Earlier if this was happening, the constitution was of India at that time was Government of India Act 1909. So according to that, asking for Swaraj or asking for home rule was not welcomed. It was termed as sedition. Now use of the term responsible government implied the condition that the rulers were answerable to the elected representatives and not only to the imperial government in London. However, it was equally clear that the British had no intention of handing power to the elected legislature with Indian majority. So basically they will say that they will be representative to the people. This is what they have said. But who will be the, how they will be elected? probably the method of election would be that only zamindars could vote. Probably the method of elections could be that that only princely states could vote. So these things were still there. Now the Indians objected to this. They said there is no time frame given when we will get this, and the second thing is government will alone decide and give it to you. So this is very difficult to assess by the government. So see, now because you are giving us self-government, if the Britishers are giving us self-government, should they not also include us in discussions? Should they not take our views? No, if they do not want to take our advice, that is fine, but or our suggestions, that is also fine, but should we not be involved in a discussion? Should we not be asked to give our views at least? So this was not there. So this chapter is over, and now the second chapter is emergence of Gandhi. So this same PDF as it is underlined here is also available on the Telegram group and the channel, so you can join that. Basically it will be on the channel because the group is mostly for discussion. Why nationalist resurgence now? The conditions in India and the influences from abroad called for a nationalist resurgence. Now the world war is over, the Montagu reforms are also there. Now why is there a need for another nationalist response now? Because there were post-war economic hardships. People wanted more. Only giving them political rights, there were not too many political rights, to be very honest, in the Montagu Clemfords. But there were many other needs, economic, social, religious reforms. All of these things were required by the Indians. And what was the actual situation? Industry. Basically, there was an increase in prices. Raw materials prices increased, labor prices increased because there is war. And then there was a recession. And along with this, there was a lot of foreign investment brought the industries on the brink of closure. So now in Britain also there was economic difficulties due to the war. The Britain could basically distracted their own country by the economic problems by investing a lot of money in India. They could avoid those problems for their own country by making investments. For example, if you know that tomorrow you are going to face a difficulty in earning money, so what you will do? You will invest somewhere so that you get better returns. So that place of investment for Britain was India. The more companies started, British companies, British backed companies started to come up in India. They had a lot of money. So the Indian industries were brought to closure and loss. For example, if Amazon comes into India, then there is definitely a loss for the those who are having offline setups, because Amazon has a lot more money than an individual shop owner. For example, Grofers and all of those are there. If you compare them with your local shopkeeper, then Grofers has a wider reach. Probably those who have been taking food or groceries from the normal shopkeeper will also be attracted towards Grofer. Many of his customers will also go. It's the ability for those sites is much more to advertise. So this is the problem there. Now workers and artisans faced unemployment and bore the brunt of high prices. Peasantry was facing high taxation and poverty. Soldiers, so now basically soldiers went abroad to fight, and at times they were also positioned in Britain and those countries which had democracy. So they returned from the battlefields and gave an idea of their experience to the rural folk. They told them, see, this is how things happen in Britain, this is how things were happening, we saw people giving vote, we saw people fighting for their rights. See, okay, they were surprised to return to a country that was even poorer than what they had left and had less liberty than before. Educated urban class, the main thing they were facing was unemployment. See, they were educated but there were not enough jobs. And there was specifically no difference between an Indian educated person and a British educated person, because the education was the same. But he was still not given the good salaries, good behavior, because he was Indian. Now, expectations of political gains for cooperation in the war. Now, basically they had, there were feeling that we will get reward because we have helped British in the war. So now nationalists were disillusioned with imperialism worldwide. Now, I told you that, see, allied powers to rally their colonies had promised them an era of democracy and self-determination after the war. So basically, self-determination was actually given by Russia to their colonies during the war itself. They told them that you can either be free or you can continue to be with us, but it is your own choice. So both sides of the war had launched vicious propaganda to malign each other. Malign means to basically throw mud at each other, basically lower their position in the society and expose each other's uncivilized colonial record. So it was seen that the Indians can now see that the Britishers are bad. A lot of publicity was given to such things. Now Paris Peace Conference and peace treaties made clear that the imperialist powers had no intention of loosening their hold over the colonies. So now the war is over. Initially they are saying they will give you self-government, but after the war is over, we see them signing contracts with each other to end the war, and they see that this is your area, you will take control only over that. So it was clear to the Indians that they lied to us. They went on to divide the colonies of the vanquished powers among themselves. So those who had won the war, instead of giving independence to the colonies like India, what they did was they also conquered those colonies which were earlier of Germany or Turkey. So neither did they give independence to their own colonies. They also did not leave the colonies which were occupied by their enemies. This eroded the myth of cultural and military superiority of the whites. Now there was also an impact of the Russian Revolution. The Bolshevik Party of the Workers overthrew the Tsarist regime and founded the first socialist state, Soviet Union. Now Tsar was a dictator there and he was thrown off. Unilaterally renounced the Tsarist imperialist rights in China and rest of Asia and gave the right of self-determination to Tsarist colonies. So basically they have ended the Tsarist rule in all of the colonies and told them that you are now free. Montagu-Clemford Reform and the Government of India Act 1919. The British government resorted to the policy of carrot and stick again. So the carrot was represented by Montagu-Clemford Reform, while the measures such as Rowlatt Act represented the stick. So now the divide and rule policy, the repression, conciliation and suppression, they are basically the same policies which are being followed by the Britain. Now what are the main features of the Government of India Act? The main features of the Government of India Act can be read through the polity section, because it is in terms of history and how it affected the national movement, only these parts will be studying here. I have completed the main features. For example, what will be the working of the act, what will be the working of the constitution. At that time we have studied in polity, but now we will see those areas which affected the freedom struggle. So now there will be diarchy in the provincial government. So there will be two lists in the provinces, that is if there is a provincial government, for example the government of Bengal, or rather not the British government of India but the British government of Bengal. In that thing, the area of functioning of the government will be divided into two areas, that is reserved and transferred. The reserved one will be controlled by the British authorities and the transferred one will be carried on by Indians who are elected by the elected in the voting, and they are members of the legislature. So they will function as democracy like we know today, but it is not democracy in the true sense, because not everybody had the right to vote, and secondly those Indians were, many of them were supported by the British to come up. So the second thing is that the central government was still without a responsible government. So this thing that they have promised self-government to us, but what they have given is diarchy. It is a half-baked self-government. It is not even self-government. So what should have been self-government throughout the British Indian government now has become only this much, that you will get some subjects in the state list. So is it enough? So these two things, that central government has shown no improvement and provincial government has shown unsatisfactory improvement, will lead to more anger in the Indians, because Indians had lost their lives fighting for the British Empire. On the home government front, the Government of India made important change that the Secretary of the State will be paid out of British Exchequer. I told you this. Now the drawbacks were that the franchisee or the right to vote was very limited. At the center, the legislature had no control over the Viceroy and his Executive Council. The division of subjects was not satisfactory at the center. So basically, state list and central list is made. That was not satisfactory. And second thing was, legislature was having no control over the viceroy. Congress reaction. Congress said that it is disappointing and unsatisfactory. They demanded self-government. Now, making of Gandhi. Now, Gandhiji had emerged on the national scene, we studied in the chapter. Now, earlier career and experiments with truth in South Africa. Having studied law in England, Gandhiji went to South Africa. So basically, he studied law in England, then went to South Africa for Dada Abdullah, for fighting a case for Dada Abdullah. He went to South Africa and he saw the white racism and the humiliation which was given to Asians and Indians in particular. So they had gone to South Africa as laborers and they were subjected to lot of racism, disabilities there. They could not walk on roads, they could not go out of their homes. So there were so many problems. He decided to stay in South Africa to organize Indian workers to enable them fight for their rights. The Indians in South Africa consisted of three categories. One, the indentured labor, mainly from South India, who had migrated to South Africa after 1890. Basically, they are the indentured laborers. Indentured laborers are basically those people who had signed the contract to work on the plantations in South Africa. They were from India. Second thing is merchants. Because the labor was going, the merchants thought they will also require Indian goods. So they also followed them. Third were those persons that their contract was expired now. So they were those laborers whose contract to work on the plantation is now over, but they are not rich enough or for other reasons they do not want to return to India. Now mostly they were illiterate and had no knowledge of English. They accepted racial discrimination as a part of daily existence. So there were only two options for the poor people there, that either they could live or they could fight against the British. See, there is no education given to them. If there is no education, then do not know English. Forget about the courts or forget about how to take benefit from the courts. Moderate phase of the struggle. Initially, Gandhiji relied on sending petitions to the authorities in South Africa and Britain, hoping that once they were informed of the plight of the Indians, they will take sincere steps. Now, Gandhiji was able to unite different sections of Indians. And he set up the Natal India Congress and started a newspaper called Indian Opinion. Any newspaper written by Gandhiji is extremely important. Phase of passive resistance or Satyagraha. Method of passive resistance or civil disobedience of Gandhiji was called as Satyagraha. Now, first Satyagraha was done against registration certificates. South African government made it compulsory for Indians to carry these certificates of registration with their fingerprints on them. So basically, to bring more control, they did this to segregate Indians from other sections of the society. This was done. Now Gandhiji was not happy with this because this was discriminatory. So they will see that these are Indians and they will start misbehaving with them or something. So he was not happy with this. So he formed the Passive Resistance Association to campaign defying the law and suffering the penalties resulting from such defiance. Defiance means that they will not follow the law. Later, the authorities used deceit to make these defiant Indians registered themselves. So basically they said that Indians are going to get special privilege, come and put your fingerprint on this paper and you will be given special benefits. So Indians under the leadership of Gandhi retaliated by burning those registration certificates. So because those registration certificates were made by fraud, so the Indians burned them up. Now, campaign against restriction on Indian migration. The Indian defied this law by crossing over one province to another by refusing to produce licenses. Now, Indians were not allowed to move from one province to another. British wanted to control their movement and keep them fixed in one place, so that they can never improve in their life. Because the places where Indians were living, they were very badly made. There was no sanitation. They were mostly like the slums. And where the Britishers were living, they were mostly like the cities. Now, campaign against poll tax and invalidation of Indian marriages. Now, the Britishers were so cruel that they decided that those whose contracts are over, they should go back to India. If they are not going, we will ask them for extra poll tax. So this was the concept of poll tax, that it was imposed on all ex-indentured laborers. Now, a Supreme Court order came out during this time, which said that if the marriage has not been done according to Christian rites and rituals, then the registrar of marriages can nullify your marriage. So basically, Indian, Hindu, Muslim, Parsi, all of those marriages could be illegal and nullified, and all, even those marriages which have happened before this judgment. So the children born out of such marriages will be illegitimate. So for example, Gandhiji was already married and he did not marry according to Christian rites, and he already had a child. So his child will be declared to be illegitimate. So all of these issues came up. And then the next was protest against Transvestite Immigration Act. Indian protested against this Immigration Act by illegally migrating from natal into transvestite. So basically, Indians were also denied to migrate from any place to transvestite. Miner and plantation went on lightning strikes. In India, Gokhale toured the whole country, mobilizing public opinion and opinion in support of Indians in South Africa. Even the Viceroy Lord Hardinge condemned the repression and called for inquiry. Now, what was the compromise? Gandhi, Hardinge, who was the Viceroy of India, and C.F. Andrews and General Smuts, two persons from the Britain and South Africa. The agreement was reached and they conceded the major Indian demands. For example, poll tax was taken care, registration certificate, marriages, and the promise to treat Indian issue of immigration in sympathetic manner. So basically, Gandhiji was able to get his way around all the problems that British had put up in South Africa. Now, Gandhiji's experience in South Africa. Masses had immense capacity to participate and sacrifice for a cause that moved them. So this is what Gandhiji learned. See, he is saying that generally masses are busy with their work, but if you can basically order their energy to work for a cause which is beneficial for all, you can have their help. He was able to unite Indians belonging to different religions and classes. At times, the leader have spoken to take decisions unpopular with their enthusiastic supporters. He was able to evolve his own style of leadership and politics and new techniques of struggle on a limited scale. Technique of Satyagraha. It was based on truth and non-violence. So what is Satyagraha now? He combined some elements from the Indian tradition with the Christian requirement of turning other cheek and the philosophy of Tolstoy, who said that evil could be countered only by non-violent resistance. So basically what he is trying to say is that he has taken the best of all the religious education and he has found out that non-violence is the best weapon. Truth and non-violence are the two most deadliest weapons. So what were the rules for the Satyagrahi? That Satyagrahi will remain truthful, non-violent and fearless, and he will withdraw cooperation and boycott. He was ready to accept suffering and hatred will be alien to his nature. Even though he is suffering, the British will be beating him up. He will still not have hate for the British. He will have love for them because he wants to reform them. Never bow before the evil, whatever the consequence, and could not justify the means. So basically, if your end is to get the freedom, then what Gandhiji is saying, that then also non-violence should not be given up. Your means, that is your way to get that freedom, should also be pure. Gandhi in India. Gandhi returned to India in January 1915. So now his methods in South Africa have been proved successful. He has been successful in getting justice for South Africans, Indians in South Africa. So now he has returned to India. He said that I will tour the country and see the condition of the masses. So he and not take any political position for at least 1 year. So till the time he says I have not seen what is going out throughout the country, till that time I will not take up any position for on any matter. He was convinced about the moderate politics and he was not in favor of home rule agitation. So basically he was convinced that the moderate politics is not good because he had seen in South Africa that moderate does not lead a lot of results. So he was not willing to join the moderates and he was not willing to join the extremists like Besant and Tilak for the home rule agitation, because he thought that it is not the best time to agitate when the Britain was in the middle of war. So Gandhiji has been focusing on purity of means. So he said that it is not a pure way to take to fight for rights when somebody is in a problem. So he was convinced that the only technique capable of meeting the nationalist aim was non-violent satyagraha. So neither the moderates nor the extremists, but a non-violent satyagraha was his only option left. He would join no political organization unless it also accepted non-violent satyagraha. Now, till now Gandhiji has not taken up any position in Congress, or he is not associated with any political group now. But individuals have started coming up to Gandhiji because they know about him. They feel that this is a person who can win us our justice, because he was a lawyer as well, and he had a huge reputation because he had helped all the Indians in South Africa. Now Champaran Satyagraha, first civil disobedience, he was requested by Rajkumar Shukla to look into the problems of farmers of Champaran, and the problem was indigo plantations. Now European planters had been forcing peasants to grow indigo on 3/20 part of their land. This was known as Tin Kathia system. Now after this, what was happening, that after the World War I, new technologies were developed by Germany. So Germany made synthetic dye which replaced indigo. So earlier indigo was required because color was taken out of it, dye was taken out of it, and it was used to dye things, dye cloth and other things. But German synthetic dyes replaced indigo. So now the European planters said that we will demand higher rents. So what happened was, the European planters were getting cheap indigo in the market. So they cheap dyes, exactly the same color they were obtaining through chemicals, which was much cheaper, and they did not have to wait. It could be produced on demand. So they, what they said was, they did not break their contracts with the farmers. Actually, it was not a contract, it was a forced contract. And now they are buying these things from somewhere else, but they are still forcing the peasants to pay money because they have broken the contract. But in fact, the British have broken the contract because they are buying from somewhere else. So now they demanded higher rents and illegal dues to maximize their profits. So they told Indians that, see, this is the amount you have to pay to come out of this and to continue as usual. The peasants were forced to sell the produce at a fixed price by the Europeans. So basically, other problem which they made was, okay, if you do not want to give this, you give us our crops at a lesser price. So they had created a huge problem from the for the people of Champaran. When Gandhiji was went there, he was joined by Rajendra Prasad, Mazharulak, Mahadev Desai, Narhari Parakh and J.B. Kriplani. Now initially the government were not allowing Gandhiji, later they agreed. The government appointed a committee to go into the matter and nominated Gandhiji as a member. Now the committee said that the Teen Kathia system should be abolished and the peasant should be compensated for illegal dues. Now those things which the Britishers have taken illegally from Indians, they should be returned. He agreed that only 25% of the money should be compensated. So basically he was also aware that if he will say that 100% of the money has to be returned, that Britishers will never agree. So he said to the government that, see, it is actually unjust and you must follow the principles of justice. So just return 25% of the money to the Indians. So basically do not look at the amount, that he was a British agent and he saved 75% of the money for Britain. But in fact, look at the effect it will have on the minds of Indian people. They will be knowing that, yes, now we can fight in an organized manner and get our way done. So these are some other important leaders. Now Ahmedabad mail strike. Now there was a dispute between cotton mill owners of Ahmedabad and the workers. Why? Because the plague bonus had been discontinued now. The workers are demanding a rise of 50% in their wages, because the workers are saying there is so much problem, world war is going on, and you have stopped the bonus. We want an increase in our wages or we will not come to work. So we want 50% increase. The mill owner said, we will give you 20% only. So there is a deadlock now. And what happened was, the mill owners dismissed the striking mill workers and decided to bring weavers from Bombay. So they said, you can go to hell, we will be bringing workers from Bombay. Ahmedabad mein people are coming from Bombay. Workers of mill टर्न टू अनुसूया साराभाई, शी वॉज अ सोशल वर्कर एंड सिस्टर ऑफ अम्बालाल, मतलब अम्बालाल वॉज द प्रेजिडेंट ऑफ अहमदाबाद मिल ओनर्स एसोसिएशन. सो अनुसूया बहन इज़ द सिस्टर ऑफ द मिल ओनर एसोसिएशन प्रेजिडेंट. शी गोज टू गांधी जी फॉर हेल्प. नाउ अनुसूया वेंट टू फॉर्म द अहमदाबाद टेक्सटाइल लेबर एसोसिएशन. गांधी आज द वर्कर्स टू गो ऑन अ स्ट्राइक एंड डिमांड 35% इंक्रीज इन द वेजेस. एंड वाइल देयर टॉक्स आर ऑन, गांधी जी वेंट ऑन अ फास्ट इन टू दैट. सो दीज इशू वर बेसिकली पीस वॉज प्रोवाइडेड इन दैट एरिया. नाउ खेड़ा सत्याग्रह फर्स्ट नॉन कोऑपरेशन. ड्राउट इन 1918 द क्रॉप्स हैड फेल्ड एंड अकॉर्डिंग टू द रिवेन्यू कोड इफ द यील्ड वॉज लेस देन 1/4 द फार्मर्स वर एंटाइटल्ड टू रेमिशन. सो नाउ वॉट यूज टू हैपन एक्चुअली, सी द थिंग इज दैट देर वॉज अ ड्रॉट एंड द क्रॉप्स हैड फेल्ड इन खेड़ा. Now, if according to the revenue code, it means that the law of income tax or the revenue, basically it was that if the yield is less than 1/4, if the yield is less than 1/4, it means that the crops had been grown which are even less than 1/4 in what happened in a normal produce. For example, if you produce 10 kgs of wheat in a year from your land, but this year there has only been 2 kgs or less than 2.5 kgs, then you will not have to pay the tax. So this was the situation at that time. The Gujarat Sabha appealed to the Britishers that please do not take revenue, and the government said that the property of those farmers will be seized if taxes are not paid. So it is unjust and unfair because they have made the code and they have put up this condition. So Gandhiji went to the area and asked the farmers not to pay the taxes. सरदार वल्लभ भाई पटेल, नरहरी पारिक, मोहनलाल पांड्या एंड रविशंकर व्यास वर द मेजर लीडर्स. गांधी जी वॉज द स्पिरिचुअल हेड ऑफ द स्ट्रगल ओनली. इवन वेन ऑन नॉन पेमेंट ऑफ टैक्सेज द गवर्नमेंट सीज द फार्मर्स पर्सनल प्रॉपर्टी एंड वास्ट मेजोरिटी ऑफ खेड़ाज फार्मर्स डिड नॉट डिजर्ट सरदार पटेल. सो बेसिकली सरदार पटेल इमर्ज्ड एज अ वेरी पावरफुल लीडर थ्रू दिस मूवमेंट. पीपल वर नॉट विलिंग टू लीव हिम even if they faced severe of the oppression. Those Indians who sought to buy the confiscated lands were socially ostracized. So now there were also some people who were trying to buy these lands which had been taken by the British. So they were being ostracized or being means everybody will cut off from them, nobody will talk to them, nobody will buy things from them, nobody will sell their goods to them. So it was a very big problem for them. The government sought to bring out an agreement with the farmers and agreed to suspend the tax for the year in question and for the next and reduce the increase in rate and return all the confiscated property. So basically Gandhiji has taken three efforts right now, and 3 out of 3 he has been able to bring justice to Indian people. Now what did he gain? Basically he showed the people the effectiveness of his Satyagraha technique. So now basically he said that moderates were also not bringing in results, extremists were not bringing their results through their own way, but look at Satyagraha, it is bringing results. He found his feet among the masses. Masses were also convinced that see, this is our leader. He acquired respect, and now the roll attack has come up. Now basically they said there were carrot and stick policy. The carrot was the Montagu, this is the stick. See, now this is what is happening. Now we remember in the World War I, there was Defense of India Act in 1915. Now it was officially called the Anarchical and Revolutionary Crimes Act, but called as Rowlatt Act. Now those Defense of India rules which were happening in the World War, they thought that British thought that these things should also be there in the normal times. Now are you imagining this, that for example there is a war going on and your freedoms are taken away at that point of time? Now the British are thinking that let us take away those freedoms in the normal time as well. So this act, Anarchical and Revolutionary Crimes Act, is known as the Rowlatt Act. This was recommendations made by the Rowlatt Commission to investigate the seditious conspiracy of the Indian people. Now the recommendations were activists should be deported or imprisoned without trial for 2 years. So basically, anybody can be put into jail for at least 2 years or more, actually 2 years or less, without facing any trial, without going to the court, without taking to the court. The police can come into your house, they can pick you up and put you in jail without even telling you the reason. And that possession of seditious newspaper would be adequate evidence of guilt. For example, you were going on the road and you picked up a piece of paper and something bad was written on it. Then also you can be taken away. Also, all the elected members of the Imperial Legislative Council voted against it. But still, the British, they were in a minority, so the bill was passed. All the then members, Jinnah, Madan Mohan Malviya and Mazhar ul Haq, resigned in protest. The act allowed political activists to be tried without juries or even imprisoned without trial. It allowed the arrest of Indians without a warrant, on mere suspicion of treason. So basically, look at the power which the police is getting. They do not even require a warrant. They will just go and tell this person, now I am going to arrest you, come. Suspects could be tried in secrecy without recourse to legal help. A lawyer will also not be provided to you. A special cell consisting of 3 high court judges will try the cases, and there is no appeal also. See, look at this. There is no appeal above the panel. The panel could even accept evidence which are not acceptable under Indian Evidences Act. The law of habeas corpus, which is the basis of civil liberty, was suspended. Now, habeas corpus means, we have studied in polity. If it is unclear to you, you can go back and refer those lectures. But it also means to have the body of. Habeas corpus means that I shall have my own body. I am the master of my body. Which is the minimum thing which should be guaranteed in a democracy. That was also not there. Leave alone democracy, human dignity is also denied. The object of the government was to replace the provisions of the Wartime Defense of India Act by permanent law. So now we will organize a satyagraha against this, or the first mass strike. Gandhiji called the Rowlatt Act as a black act and said that everyone should not get punishment in response to isolated political crimes. So basically, if someone in some part of India has written something wrong about you, then go and punish him, even if you want to. You cannot punish everybody. Gandhiji called for a mass protest at all India level. He organized the Satyagraha Sabha and roped in the younger members of Home Rule Leagues and the Pan-Islamists. The forms of protest chosen were nationwide hartal, fasting, prayer, civil disobedience against specific laws, and courting arrest and imprisonment. So Gandhiji is now arranging that I will launch a mass movement against this. We will later see that this did not fructify, but see, he has begun the planning. We have to go step by step in history. We cannot presume that see, hua to thani, this is not important. To understand the history, it is important that you see everything. Okay, so now Gandhiji is against this. He said Rowlatt Act is bad and I will organize Satyagraha for this now. So Gandhiji has now gained experience and confidence. People believe in him because of his Kheda, Champaran and Ahmedabad endeavors. And now he is willing to launch a Satyagraha against this law. Okay, so there was a radical change by the situation now. Why was he taking up an all India scale organization? Because masses had found a direction. They could act instead of giving verbal expression to their grievances. Peasants, artisans and urban poor will play an increasing role in the struggle. Orientation of the national movement will be turned to the masses permanently, and Satyagraha will be launched on April 6. This is what the Gandhiji has said. But before it can be launched, there were large-scale violent anti-British demonstrations. So, and basically the problem was very much in Punjab. So the main problem which started was in Punjab. So Rowlatt Act was happening, people started protesting, it became non-violent to an extent because Gandhiji is new, he has not been able to convince everybody for non-violence. Where the crowd is less, at that time when Gandhiji is also there, they can be controlled. But the situation is when there is an all India strike happening, people will become emotional. They will see money lenders who have troubled them for years and years. They will try and kill them. Now, army had to be called in. In April 1919, saw the biggest and most violent anti-British upsurge since 1857. People have gone out of control. They think that the Britishers can never help us. Now, look at what the Indians are feeling. We have supported your war. We have supported a war in which Britain is fighting. because we feel you are just people, but look at what you are doing with us. Now, the Lieutenant Governor of Punjab, now look at this very importantly. Michael Dwyer used aircraft strafing against violent protesters. Now, what is this aircraft strafing? Have you seen The Matrix or any movie in which there is a machine gun put on the aircraft and then a lot of rounds are fired from the aircraft? So there are people who are protesting and he is using that gun against them. So look at, they are used in wars. They are used against armed people. Now, they were armed in the sense they have guns, armed in the sense not ki you, they are holding stones in hand and you are using this gun. So look at his personality, or look at him, that he has the guts to use this. He was a lieutenant governor. Okay. Now, Jallianwala Bagh massacre. Now, this is completely relating to situation in Punjab, because the Jallianwala Bagh took place in Punjab. On April 9, two leaders, Saifuddin Kijlu and Satyapal, were arrested without any provocation. So basically, what happened was that there are two leaders who had respect in the society. They are taken without any provocation. So basically, Rowlatt Act has not come out right now, but still it has been started using. So this caused resentment, and they came out on April 10 to show their solidarity with the leaders. So Dr. Satyapal and Saifuddin Kichlu were arrested, and then Indians showed that we are unhappy with this, so we will go to the streets. When they were on the streets, the police resorted to firing and the protest became violent. Protesters were killed, and then there was a riot all over Punjab, and in that riot 5 Englishmen were killed, and Marcella Sherwood, who was a missionary means she was spreading Christianity, she would maybe have been a nun, she was going on a bicycle, she was beaten up by the crowds. So troops were sent immediately to quell the disturbances. So now the army has been sent up. How did you kill 5 Englishmen and beat up an English woman who was a woman of God? So now Brigadier General Reginald Dyer, the senior British officer, was imposed martial law, and he was given the responsibility to restore order. Now he told on April 13 that people will not be allowed to leave the city without a pass, and they will not be allowed to organize any procession or protest or assembly in a group of more than 3. So basically, wherever Dyer is now saying that wherever I will see people who are more than 3 in number, he just put up a circular in his office and people are not aware of it. So because nobody is visiting their offices, and they are not even allowed because of racism to enter those areas. Now, on the Baisakhi day, large crowd of people were gathered because it is a festival, people will gather, and they were unaware of the prohibitory orders in the city. They were celebrating Baisakhi festival. The meeting was peaceful, and you know what happens in the meetings in villages or other areas, that whenever there is a function, even now when there is Ram Leela or any other function, one or the other political leader comes up to say very, very congratulations for Ram Leela, very good, we are very happy, Ramji came back, this happened, that happened, it is a victory of good over evil. And then so the same thing was happening in the Baisakhi festival. The political leaders were also there in the function. So meeting was going on peacefully, and the people decided to pass 2 resolutions, one against the Rowlatt Act and the other condemning the firing on April 10th. So basically, we had seen that people were fired upon. So they said these 2 things are very bad. So when this happened, General Dyer entered. So now look at this, there is no specific problem with them. They are not terrorists, they are not revolutionaries, they are not even extremists. They are just celebrating their festival, and they are just saying that see, these 2 things are bad. Now the troops surrounded the gathering ordered from General Dyer, and blocked off the exit point and opened fire on the unarmed crowd. No warning was issued and no instruction to disperse was given. So usually what happens is, if you are going to fire on somebody or there is a crowd which is unruly, you first issue an warning you please go off, otherwise you will have to do lathi charge. Even before lathi charge, you are actually the police has to stop for some time. But look at this person, he goes inside and starts firing without telling them to disperse or anything else. They were followed by uncivilized brutalities on the inhabitants of Amritsar. मार्शल लॉ वॉज प्रोक्लेम्ड एंड पब्लिक फ्लॉगिंग्स वर एंड ह्यूमिलिएशन वर परपेट्रेटेड. बेसिकली पीपल वर कॉल्ड आउट ऑफ देयर होम्स इन द मार्शल लॉ एंड दे वर बीटन अप इन फ्रंट ऑफ एवरीबडी. Indians were forced to crawl on their bellies on the road on which English missionary had been assaulted. We read na, Marcella Sherwood was beaten up. Now they called all the Indians of the area, took them to that road and made them crawl on their bellies. So look at this, look at their behavior. So the entire nation was stunned. Rabindranath Tagore renounced his knighthood in protest. Gandhiji gave up the title of Kesari Hind. So this is a type of protest which, apart from this, the Indians could not do anything. What could they do? What happened in Amritsar made Gandhiji declare that cooperation with the satanic regime was now impossible. He realized that the cause of Indian independence was morally righteous. So now basically he was more convinced that Satyagraha will be there, because Satyagraha is a fight for truth. Satyagraha, Satya in itself means truth. So now he is saying that I will take up this fight because it is righteous, but not right now, because non-violence cannot be maintained at this time, because the situation will become very violent. Now Uddham Singh, who took the name Ram Mohammad Singh Azad, assassinated Michael O'Dwyer. He is not General Dyer, but Michael O'Dwyer, who was the lieutenant governor who had fired using aircraft strafings. So he killed that person. Now Hunter Committee, now such a huge issue has taken place. Now can the Indian people keep quiet? They said, we want justice. We want an inquiry into whatever has happened. So Government of India announced formation of Disorder Inquiry Committee. So this is the real name of the Hunter Committee, which came to be known as Hunter Commission. Yeah, Hunter Committee, because the chairman name was Hunter. Okay? The purpose of the commission was to investigate the disturbances Bombay, Delhi and Punjab, their causes and measure taken to cope up with them. So this is not exactly dealing with the ill effects of General Dyer's actions, but it is a general committee. There were three members: Sir Chimanlal Harilal Setalwad, this is one name, okay, Pandit Jagat Narayan, and Sardar Sahibzada Sultan Ahmad Khan. This is also another person. Okay? Dyer was called before the committee. Dyer stated that his, now you must look at this to know their actual attitude. Dyer stated that his intentions had been to strike terror throughout Punjab. So he is a government servant. Now what he is thinking is, I will strike terror in these people. He will reduce the moral stature of the rebels. So those who are protesting peacefully, they are calling him rebels. Now Dyer is reported to have explained his sense of honor. He was feeling very proud that he has done. I think it was quite possible that I could have dispersed the crowd without firing, but they would have come back again and laughed. So basically, I would have made a fool of myself. Now look at this person. He is concerned of his image. Do you realize that there were women, there were elderly people, there were children in the crowd, and you are firing upon them, and they were unarmed. He also stated that he did not make any effort to tend to the wounded after the shooting, as it was not his job. He said that it is not my responsibility. Those who were killed or those who were injured, they should have taken their relatives to the hospital. The report stated that the lack of notice to disperse from the bag in the beginning was an error. The length of firing was an error. The motive of producing sufficient moral effect was to be condemned. And Dyer had overstepped the bound of his authority. There had been no conspiracy to overthrow the British rule in Punjab. Now, the minority report of the Indian members, so basically there were three Indian members as well, they also added some things. See that the proclamations of banning the public meetings were not publicized enough. Dyer should have either ordered his troops to help the wounded or instructed civil authorities to do so. So basically what they are saying is, we understand that it is not your responsibility. Even if it is not your responsibility, you should have ordered the civil administration of Punjab to take care of these people. You did not even do that. So his actions are inhuman and un-British and injured the image of British rule in India. So now Indian people who were expecting self-government of the First World War, now they have seen that we are being fired upon. Rowlatt Act has been brought, and what have they given in return? A diarchy, a useless diarchy. So now this will enrage the people of India. this will bring in a fire. I think you also must be feeling that how bad these people are. And now if you see that most of us are also still appreciating the British, for example, we want to go abroad, we want to live abroad. But see, this is their actual face. Dyer should have either ordered his troops to help the wounded or instructed, this is done. Now, the Hunter Committee did not impose any penal or disciplinary action because Dyer's actions were condoned by various superiors. Now, Hunter Committee was just a committee, but those who had made this committee, those who had ordered this committee, they were giving appreciation to Dyer. Now, what could the committee do? So, they said that, see, he is a bad person. Only this is what they said and nothing else happened. Also, before the Hunter Committee began its proceedings, the government has passed an Indemnity Act for the protection of officers. This was called as the whitewashing bill. See, now what is an indemnity act is that whenever government servant is on duty, if something wrong happens, he will not be personally liable for what he has done. So this act was passed. We studied this in the polity as well, that a civil servant gets personal immunity for the official acts done. So this act was passed and no action could be taken against Dyer now. So now, finally what happened in England was, they decided that Dyer should be dismissed, and this was conveyed to the Army Council. In the end, Dyer was found guilty of a mistaken notion of duty. So basically what they are saying is that there was a misunderstanding. So if this person has done such a big blunder, he is worse than many of the terrorists that are going around in the world today. But what is the British reading of this? They are saying that this person misunderstood what had happened. So only that was his only mistake. So but because he is not able to see what his duty is, we will relieve him of his command. So he was recalled to England. No legal action was taken against him. He drew half of his pay and received army pension. So basically he is getting pension also. He is getting half of his pay also. But now he will work in England. So there was, what did he lose? He lost nothing. In the House of Lords, basically in the British Parliament's upper house, most of the peers favored Dyer and the House passed a motion in his support. The Morning Post is a newspaper. They raised £26,000 for Dyer, and a famous contributor was Rudyard Kipling. He was a very famous author. Many people read his books today also. And now this is one of the most shocking parts which happened. The clergy of the Golden Temple, that is basically the priests there, led by Arur Singh, honored Dyer by declaring him a Sikh. Most of the Sikhs were killed in the Jallianwala Bagh. And look at the corruption in the religious sphere, that they have declared him a Sikh. So see now that how difficult it was to get independence in such situations. What the task was our national leaders were having at their time. Because those who are communal, they are deriving their authority from the British. Even after such things, they had no fear that we will announce Dyer as a Sikh, we will honor him, and they will still not face any social repression. This is the kind of security given to them. And all of the movements which you are reading are only happening in British provinces. They are not happening in the princely states, because in the princely states there is absolute protection given to the princes. There are no laws there. The princely states prince is the main leader there. He makes the law. Basically, the British residents also makes the law, but the people do not have any right there, because there the arrangement is that the prince is the king there. Basically, prince they are calling because the king is in England. So the prince is the main in charge there, and he will decide what the rights are, because democracy had never come there. These laws, Government of India Act, etc., were only for the British provinces and not for the princely states. Now, Congress view. Congress appointed its own committee headed by, included Motilal Nehru, C.R. Das, Abbas Tabji, M.R. Jaikar and Gandhi. They said that Gandhi was inhuman and there was no justification for introduction of martial law in Punjab. So, theek hai, Congress also said something, it had to say something. They have not done very effective right now. Now, the Congress will start action. Now, the situation is a bit peaceful. They think that now it is a good time to act. Chapter 16, Non-Cooperation Movement and Khilafat Andolan. Now, this issue of Khilafat was not directly linked to Indian politics, but provided the immediate background to the movement and gave an added advantage of cementing Hindu-Muslim unity against the British. So, what is the background? Now, after the First World War had ended, basically all the hopes of generosity towards Indian subjects were belied. So we had seen belied. We have seen what the behavior was after the First World War. Okay. So the rise in prices, decrease in production, increase in taxes, all the sections suffered, and they had this has strengthened the anti-British attitude in India. Now, Rowlatt Act, imposition of martial law in Punjab, Jallianwala Bagh, all of these things had fired up the Indian people now. The Hunter Committee report, basically, even if they would have taken action against Dyer, then we would have thought that, okay, still moderate methods have some hope, extremist methods have some hope. Now, those who are seeing these situations, they will be definitely be moving towards revolutionary terrorism. So now, but to thank God, there is Gandhiji. He is still able to keep the people non-violent. Now, Montagu Clamford reform, with all their inconcealed scheme of hierarchy, failed to satisfy the people. Now, a ground for political action was set by Hindus and Muslims in the Lucknow Pact. The Rowlatt Act brought Hindus and Muslims together, and radical nationalist Muslims, those who were younger elements, now became more influential than the conservative Aligarh school elements. So basically that thought where we have to align with the government is now weakening a bit, because Muslims are also saying that we are not given a lot much by the British. Now, what was the Khilafat issue? The Muslims were angered by the treatment meted out to Turkey by the British after the First World War. Muslims in India, as well as all over the world, regarded Sultan of Turkey as their spiritual leader, that is the Khalifa. Turkey had allied with Germany and Austria against the British. When the war ended, British took a stern attitude and divided Turkey and removed Khalifa. So the Indian Muslims were not happy because of this. In India too, Muslims demanded that the Khalifa's control over the Muslim sacred places be retained and should be left with sufficient territories. So this was not happening at all. Now, the Khilafat Committee was formed under leadership of Ali brothers Shaukat Ali and Muhammad Ali, Maulana Azad, Ajmal Khan and Hasrat Mohani, to force British government to change attitude towards the Turkey. Now, development of the Khilafat Non-Cooperation Program. The All India Khilafat Conference was held in Delhi, and a call was made for boycott of British goods. The Khilafat leaders spelt out that unless peace terms after the war was favorable to Turkey, they would stop all cooperation with the government. And Gandhi, who was president of the Khilafat committee, saw in the issue a platform which could unite non-cooperation and be declared against the government. United non-cooperation could be declared against the government. So see, Gandhiji is saying that, see, this is a brilliant opportunity. Let us support the Muslims in their cause and put up joint demands. Congress stand. The Congress was not united on this because Tilak was opposed to having an alliance with Muslim leaders over a religious issue. See, now what Tilak is saying is, see, that this is a matter relating to Turkey. How does it help us? And secondly, basically it is a religious issue. If it is a religious reform, see, Hindus are doing their religious reform on their own, Parsis are doing it on their own, Sikhs are doing it on their own. Then he felt that Muslims should carry out their reform on their own. And what is the role of Hindus or Muslims roles of Christians or Hindus or Sikhs in this? So this was the view of Tilak. And there was also opposition against Gandhi's non-cooperation program, such as boycott of councils. And though there were still some people who believed that we will work in the councils, so the moderates were still active in the Congress at this time. Even after so much wrongs, the moderates were still there. And that section said that this is wrong because I will not give up the council. I will work in the council because it was because of huge efforts that we have got a place in the council. I will not throw it away like this. Tilak, on the other hand, was opposing that this is actually a religious issue and this should not be taken up politically. So other sections also saying that Satyagraha is not very useful. So there was a division among the Congress. Congress felt inclined to support non-cooperation program on the Khilafat issue because finally this is what happened, that it was a golden opportunity to cement Hindu-Muslim unity. The Congress was losing faith in constitutional struggle, especially after the Punjab incidents and blatantly partisan Hunter Commission report. The Congress was aware that the masses were eager to give expression to discontent. So Congress said, no matter whatever the cause for the movement is, let us now launch a movement because the masses are waiting for something to happen. So now non-cooperation Khilafat movement has begun. Joint Hindu Muslim deputation was sent to the Viceroy, and Gandhi announced that soon a movement will be launched if the peace treaty failed to satisfy the Indian Muslims. Now what did the government do? They formed the Treaty of Sevres and dismembered Turkey. Now Turkey was divided into many small parts. Now in response to this, all party conference was held at Allahabad and approved a program of boycott of school, colleges, law courts, and asked Gandhi to lead it. So now they have decided that Gandhiji will be the leader. Now 1920 August, the Khilafat committee started a campaign of non-cooperation movement, and it was formally launched. Now basically Tilak, who was mainly the opposing person, he has died. So now earlier also during the when extremists were admitted, then also two persons died, and now also Tilak has died, so the work is easier. So we will see this in the course of history. Even today also we see that when somebody dies in politics, it becomes a major gain for another party. September 1920, at a special session in Calcutta, the Congress approved non-cooperation program till Punjab and Khilafat were removed. Now boycott of government schools and colleges, boycott of law courts and dispensation of justice through panchayats, boycott of legislative councils. Now C.R. Das was still saying that no, I will not do it, but he finally agreed. Boycott of foreign cloth and use of khadi, renunciation of government honors and titles. Now in the second phase, now they have decided that this is what we will do initially, but in the second phase we will carry out mass civil disobedience, including resignation from government service and non-payment of taxes. Now they will also work for Hindu Muslim unity and for removal of untouchability, all the time remaining non-violent. Now in December 1920, Nagpur session of Indian National Congress, the program of non-cooperation was endorsed. The Congress decided to have attainment of Swaraj through peaceful and legitimate means and committing to extra-constitutional mass struggle. So earlier what was the thing was that the struggle of the Congress was constitutional struggle. The basic Congress's document which were there, they wrote that the means to attain freedom will be constitutional struggle. But now they are saying legitimate means. Legitimate means that legitimacy is those things which are approved by the people, rather than going to the British for approval that we are following your constitution. What the British will do, so the Indians will do, that they will take up the support of Indians and they will ask them, do you think it is legitimate that we break the laws, that if we go out of the view of the constitution, carry out the struggle? So now this is a major change in government, in the Congress. In 1920 Nagpur session, they have committed themselves to take legitimate means and commit itself to extra constitutional mass struggle. Now changes were made. So now, because something big is going to happen, Congress working committee of 15 members were set up and provincial Congress committees on linguistic basis were organized. Now Gandhiji declared that if non-cooperation program was implemented completely, Swaraj will be there in a year. Many groups of revolutionary terrorists, those from Bengal, pledged support to the Congress. So now revolutionary terrorists, basically those who were, see here he has written revolutionary terrorists, but this book of Bipin Chandra was brought into a lot of criticism and banned also, because the term terrorist was used. So I am not using this term, it is written in the book, please. Okay, especially those from the Bengal also pledged support to Congress. Earlier, those who have started preparing now, earlier revolutionaries had terrorists attached with them every time. Now it is found only in some cases. So this is the only place where they have forgot to omit this. So when they say that it is an updated version of the spectrum, so most of the things are these only, that they have removed the word terrorist. So even if you have a newer version of the spectrum, it is not making a lot of difference, okay? Because history has happened, it is not going to change in a single day. It remains the same. and this story of how we got independence is going to remain the same. So do not go after buying the spectrum every time you see that a new has been launched. Now, leaders like Muhammad Ali Jinnah, Besant Khadpade and Bipin Chandra Pal left the Congress as they believed in a constitutional and lawful struggle. So earlier they were all a part of the what we call Congress, but now because Congress is declaring that we will take up extra constitutional struggle, so all these people have left the Congress. Surendranath Banerjee was also agitated by this and he founded a new party, Indian National Liberation Federation, and played a minor role. So because he was also believing in constitutional struggle and he lost importance after that. Now, spread of the movement. Gandhi, accompanied by Ali brothers, took a nationwide tour. Thousands of the students left the colleges and joined 800 national schools. Now, they were under the leadership of Acharya Narendra Dev, C.R. Das, Lala Lajpat Rai. Subhash Bose became the principal of National College at Calcutta. And there were also Jamia Millia at Aligarh, Kashi Vidyapeet, Gujarat Vidyapeet, Bihar Vidyapeet. So these colleges came up. These were the persons who organized them. And Subhash Bose became the principal of National College at Calcutta. This is important. That Subhash Bose was the principal. Many lawyers gave up their practice. Okay. Heaps of foreign clothes were burnt. Picketing of shops, selling foreign liquor and toddy shops. Picketing means gherao, or basically going inside and picking the things out and wasting them. Tilak Swaraj fund was oversubscribed and 1 crore rupees were collected. Congress volunteer corps emerged as the parallel police. In July 1921, Ali brothers said that Muslims should resign from the army as it was unreligious. Now the Congress also gave the call to the local bodies to start civil disobedience. If it was thought that the people were ready for it, already no tax movement have been started in Midnapur and Guntur. So these two are important places that here the civil disobedience was going already. In Assam, tea plantation strikes were there. In steamer services and Assam Bengal Railway had been organized by J.M. Sen Gupta. Awadh Kisan movement, Ekam movement, Mapila revolt, Sikh agitation for removal of Mahants, all of these things happened. People response, middle class led the movement in the beginning, but later they showed lot of reservations. Their response to give resign from the government service and surrendering of the title were not taken seriously. Now basically middle class cannot lose its government job, even today also. They will rather support somebody who is unjust rather than giving up their government jobs. Now Rajendra Prasad in Bihar and Vallabhbhai Patel provided solid support, and leaders like them found non-cooperation to be viable political solution to terrorism in all revolutionary activities to fight against the colonial government. Now business class, boycott received support from Indian business groups because they benefit, because when there will be Swaraji, basically Swadeshi goods will be used, then the business class will benefit. But big businessmen were skeptical because they thought that the labor will start striking in their industries. Peasants' participation was massive, and basically in Bihar the confrontation between the lower and the upper caste on the issue of taking a sacred thread got merged with the non-cooperation movement. So basically this can be asked that where was this issue merged with the movement of non-cooperation, that this lower caste were not taking the sacred thread and the upper caste were taking. So this was in Bihar. Students became active volunteers. Thousands of them left the government schools and colleges. Women gave up parda and offered ornaments for Tilak fund. They joined the movement in large numbers and took active part in picketing. Now, Hindu-Muslim unity. There was Hindu-Muslim unity during the votes. It is understood, na? Because All India Khilafat Committee is there. They are taking joint decisions. So there is going to be Indian unity. Now, government response. Now they will try to divide and rule again. Government wanted to urge the Ali brothers to remove those portions of the speech which suggested violence. Now, Gandhi was very clever. He realized that the government was trying to drive a wedge between him and the Khilafat leaders and refused to fall into the trap. Volunteer corps were declared. Now, when they saw that Gandhi is not responding, what the government did was all the volunteer associations were declared illegal. Public meetings were banned, press was gagged, and most of the leaders barring Gandhi were arrested. So now they thought that if we will arrest Gandhi, there will be a problem. Let us arrest everybody else other than Gandhi. Let us see what he will be doing alone. Now, last phase of the movement. Gandhi was now under increasing pressure to start the civil disobedience movement. So now, because the second phase had to be a civil disobedience movement, they decided that we will launch this now. Now, Gandhi was the sole authority to answer this. On February 1, Gandhi threatened to launch the civil disobedience from Gujarat if the political prisoners were not released and the press control were not removed. So, because you see that all the leaders other than Gandhi were taken. Now, when all of this was going on, Chori Chora incident started up, which prompted Gandhi to withdraw the movement. Police had beaten up the leader of volunteers campaigning against liquor sale and high food prices. So now this was also going on peacefully. Okay, police came and open fired on the crowd which had come to protest before the police station. The agitated crowd torched the police station. See, I told you that right now Satyagraha is not very inbuilt into the people because they have not yet learned the art of non-violence and loving your enemy. The agitated crowd's torch means they lit fire on the police station, and those who were inside the policemen, those policemen who were inside, they all were burnt. Okay. Gandhiji was not happy with the non-violent trend and announced the withdrawal of the movement. Congress committee met at Bardoloi and resolved to stop all activity that led to violence, breaking of the law, and get down to constructive work. So basically the Congress has seen that now violence is erupting. So we will not do the civil disobedience. Breaking of the law means civil disobedience, and get down to constructive work, which will be popularization of Khadi, national schools, campaign for temperance, Hindu Muslim unity and untouchability. And now Gandhiji was also arrested, and 6 years he was put in jail. He was given a sentence to be put up in 6 years in jail. He was withdrawn early, but this was the problem. Now Gandhi withdrew the movement because people had not learned the meaning of non-violence. A violent movement could be easily suppressed by the colonial regime, who would make the indictments of violence an excuse for armed might of the state. So now basically if you are trying to convince them that do not bring in defense of India rules, etc., for that you need to be non-violent. If you will be violent, then they will be more convinced that the defense of India rules through the Rowlatt Act is needed. The movement was also showing signs of fatigue. It was natural that it is not possible to sustain with high pitch for very long. The government seemed to be in no mood for negotiation. The central theme of the agitation, basically the main issue, was to address the Khilafat wrongs. Basically, had they also taken up the issue of Punjab and Rowlatt Act and all of those things, then they could have continued. But they made Khilafat as the central movement. But what happened in Turkey? The people rose under Kemal Pasha and derived the Sultan of the political power. Turkey was made a secular state and the Khilafat question lost its relevance. Now the people of themselves were not wanting a rule of the Sultan, and here Indian people are protesting against the British. So will it not be foolish? So all of these things were led to the decline of the movement. Evaluation. The movement brought urban Muslims into the national movement, but at the same time communalized the politics. Communalized because they are taking religious issues into politics of the day. The nationalist leaders failed to raise the political consciousness of the Muslims to a level of secular political consciousness. Now, nationalist sentiments breached every nook and corner of the country and politicized every strata of population. So this is the effect of now. They are basically students, urban poor, women, trader, every person is now participating. Now this important conclusion is that colonial rule was based on two myths. One was that British rule was in the interest of Indians, and the second was that it was invincible. See, first thing they are believing is that the British rule is good for India. The second thing that Indians believed was that the Britishers cannot be defeated. But the first myth had been exploited by the economic critique of the moderates. Now moderates told the Indian people that the Britishers are not good for the country. And the second myth had now been challenged by Satyagraha. Gandhiji made the people believe that yes, we can challenge the Britishers, no matter how powerful they are, no matter what the situation is, we can challenge the Britishers. So now with this, today's class is complete, and I would request you all to study modern history also properly, because after the test you have on Sunday on Indian polity, you will also have a test on Indian history the next Sunday. The test will include one essay and 6 to 7 questions of polity. It will be a 3-hour test. So more details will be shared on the Telegram group and the channel, and those of you who are interested, you can join it. Thank you so much. Please share and subscribe.